Well, thank you all for sticking around for the final act here. Those of you who are averse to cigarette smoke, I don't smoke cigarettes. Just inhale. See, I'm a magician. I'm a magician who loves to travel, like a lot of you. I love to travel the world. Special effect. I love to travel the world because travel is a lot like magic. It's full of, well, discovery, surprise, revelation, and wonder. Now, the great travel writer, Pico Iyer, he said, we travel to find ourselves, and we travel to lose ourselves. We travel to open our hearts and eyes and learn more about our world than books, magazines, newspapers, even the internet can accommodate. Iyer goes on to say that the real thrill, the real joy of traveling is seeing everything that you thought and knew in a different light. A different light that often exposes, you know, our pre-existing prejudices, fears, false beliefs about a people, a place. Now, as many of you know, the kind of travel experience that you have is largely dependent on the attitude that we take with us, the attitude of the tourist, say, versus the attitude of the traveler. The tourist, for instance, truly believes that there really is no place like home. So travel for him is really a travail. He's always complaining because he's always comparing. He says things like, God, don't these people believe in air conditioning? As if air conditioning was a belief. And God had anything to do with it. Now, he's more comfortable with the familiar, the known. Whereas the traveler, he's more comfortable with the unfamiliar, the different, the unusual, strange. He's on a journey of discovery where anything can happen, and often does. And when he returns, when the traveler returns, you know, he comes back with a new appreciation for not only what he has, but for what there is to offer elsewhere. So tonight, I thought I would share with you a trip that I took in the spirit of a traveler in the fall of 2003. Oh, and one more thing. Everything you're about to hear really happened, as opposed to Mike Daisy. I decided to travel outside of my comfort zone. Not that far. I booked a trip to the Amazon jungle of Peru. So I flew to Lima from San Francisco, and then took a small plane to Pacalipa in the eastern part of the country, where I met a group of travelers and my Peruvian guide, Manolo, for a four-day trek into the Amazon. Well, the jungle was teeming with all kinds of exotic wildlife and plants. This is our home, said Manolo, proudly. It's also what you would call our pharmacy. You see, there's a cure here for everything that ails you. There's a plant for headache, infection, depression, old age, arthritis, rheumatism, backache, even sex, all for free. Wow, I thought, I hope Pfizer doesn't find out about this, or the Amazon's really in trouble. Well, as the afternoon wore on, I saw monkeys, I saw parrots, I saw all manner of insects, really strange looking ones. In fact, there was a large blue caterpillar on a leaf, and as I bent down to take a closer look, Manolo grabbed my hand, he goes, Michael, Be careful what you touch. There are poisonous insects, disease-bearing leeches, tarantulas, and most feared of all, a snake that can kill you in a matter of minutes with one quick strike. It's called the chichupe. The chichupe. Sounds like something you'd get at Taco Bell. But Manolo was serious, you know. I don't recall hearing about all these horrible creatures in my beautifully illustrated Peruvian travel brochure. I do recall hearing about the chichupe in a documentary by the great German film director Werner Herzog. He was shooting his film Fitzcarraldo when one of his crew was clearing an area where the chainsaw was attacked by a chichupe. And I'm going to let Herzog describe what happened, because I don't do Herzog.
Suddenly, this man feels a snake striking him twice, and it was a chuchupe. This is the most dangerous snake of all. Normally, it takes only a few minutes before cardiac arrest occurs and breathing stops. And he dropped the saw, the power was cut off, and he thought about it for 5 seconds. And then he grabbed the saw again, started it up the way you start an outboard motor, and cut off his foot. And that saved his life because our camp with the doctor and the serum was 20 minutes away.
I mean, there I was, 1 minute walking through the garden of universal health care, and the next minute fearing death by caterpillars, leeches, vicious snakes. Now, I'm familiar with snakes and leeches. I worked in the advertising business for a couple of years. But this was different. Manolo could see I was anxious. He put his hand on my shoulder and said, "Michael, pay attention. Pay attention. You'll be fine." And a calmness sort of came over me. The fear fell away. And as darkness came, we made camp in a clearing. My guides cooked a sumptuous meal of corn and potatoes, chicken with garlic, red peppers. It was a traditional Peruvian chicken soup. Well, I was on my second bowl when Manolo came up to me and said, "Michael, we hear you are a magic man. Would you share with us some of your magic, man?" Well, often when I'm traveling and my fellow travelers learn that I'm a magician, they'll ask me to do a trick. So I'll look around for something to improvise with. And on this occasion, I picked up my soup spoon. So I walked up to the group gathered around the fireplace, and I said, "Now, I will attempt to place this large soup spoon in the small area known as the inside of my mouth." Well, the response was underwhelming, as it was here tonight, but I wasn't finished. Now, I will attempt to repeat the same trick, but this time, I will use only my tongue, only the tongue, to turn the spoon over. Were blown away because they really believe in magic. And they really thought that I possessed these magical powers. You know, like a shaman. Far be it for me to discourage that thought. So that night, actually, I know Manolo was impressed because he came to my tent and he woke me up with a surprising suggestion. Michael. Yes. Would you like to go and visit a shaman in a nearby village? A shaman, I thought. Wow, the spiritual leader, medicine man, miracle worker? Absolutely, I said. Then, get dressed, don't wake the others. Follow me. Well, I followed him into the jungle, which was even more terrifying in the pitch black darkness. I kept trying to remember the words of Manolo. Pay attention, pay attention, pay attention. But it was the words of Herzog that kept following with every step that I took.
Was bitten by a snake, was bitten by a snake. It was a chuchupe, chuchupe, chuchupe. Most dangerous snake of all. And cut off his foot, and cut off his foot, and cut off his foot.
Well, we finally got to the village. There was a smattering of thatched huts. Manolo went into one, and then he came out a few minutes later and beckoned me to come in. So I went in, and it was a single room. There was a dirt floor. There was a straw mat. There was a small shrine in the corner. He handed me a mat. Light this candle, he said. And it was then that the shaman slowly emerged in the dim light. Bare feet, tattered shorts, no shirt, shoulder-length hair, and a faded baseball cap on his head. I told him you were a magic man, said Manolo, and he wants to share with you his magic, man. The shaman brought out a wooden box. Manolo translated as he began. We, he said, seldom see people like you in our village. There was a man who came to visit us once from the north. He wished to know more about our people. And so, for 7 weeks, he came to live with us. He was a good man. So we embraced him as he embraced us. We became close, very close. And then he moved among us freely, got to know our culture, our ways. And then, after 7 weeks, he left us. Returned north, talked about the people he'd seen, the people he'd met, the things he, friends he had made, and also how he discovered something he'd never found anywhere else, how he had found a home. And so he returned to us, returned to a large celebration. And then, in a ceremony attempted by the whole village, he became a permanent member of our tribe. Forever. Well, the shaman handed me the ropes. He wants you to keep them to remember this time and place, said Manolo. And so, I returned to San Francisco with the memories of the wise and gentle Manolo. The shaman who shared his magic. The jungle and all its beauty and ability to scare the living crap out of you. the people and the country of Peru. All the reasons we travel in the first place, and how these things all remind us of how we're all connected as one people to each other and to this place we all call home. Thank you very much.